Hi everyone, I'm Melissa from Knitting the Stash, and this is episode 11 of the podcast series. I'm coming to you from sunny Colorado. Well, actually, when you guys see this, I'll be home, but right now, you can imagine that I'm still here. It's been a lovely spring break here, away from teaching, and we've had a chance to visit with Spencer's mom and have some fun out here, have some field trips actually. So I'll talk about a field trip that we took to Aniroonz Sheep Company. And I want to talk about the sweater that I'm wearing. It is the Aileas sweater. And I have some fun acquisition stuff to talk to you guys about. So, jump right in. You can find me everywhere else on Ravelry, on Instagram, on YouTube obviously, and then on the blog as Knitting the Stash. And the blog is knittingthestash.wordpress.com. I'm hoping that the sound is going to be good out here today. I tested it earlier. It's a little windy, so I'm going to try to speak up and project, and we'll see how that goes. So, since I'm outside, I have my show notes on a tiny piece of paper. We'll see how that works out. And as the wind is picking up, it's getting a little wild, so we'll see. It's so pretty out here, I just can't not be outside. Okay, so first things first, the sweater I'm wearing. I wanted to give you the rundown on the Aileas, and I don't have my dress form with me, so I'm just going to talk about it a little bit, and I'm going to insert some pictures here so that you'll be able to see it more up close. But basically, it is a cardigan knit top down. All right, I'll give you the full tour here. This is the back. Right, and I did some cool contrast color on the inside collar, and it does not, as those of you who are truly astute viewers will know, it doesn't have any buttons yet, and that is because I have not been able to decide on really cool buttons. So if you guys have recommendations for good Etsy shops where there are kind of funky buttons, I love buttons that have little etchings or a little art or just a little something funky about them. If you have recommendations, please comment and let me know, because I'd love to support independent businesses, as you guys know, and I'd love to find some really funky buttons for this sweater. So the sweater is a top-down cardigan. It's by Isabel Kramer. It's called Aileas, and it knit up really fast. I knit it in some Shetland, worsted Shetland that I had in my stash. Local Illinois Shetland, which is really cool. I think I talked about that on the last episode. It was a little bit challenging. It had its own challenges to knit with. It was a very different kind of yarn to knit with, and I loved every minute of it. And I love the final result. As I said earlier on in the other podcast, it's a little bit of a dark color. I dyed it myself. I kettle dyed it with acid dyes. It was a brown, kind of speckled, heathered Shetland, and I kettle dyed it into this deep kind of eggplant that has some variations. Let's see if the camera can pick up on it. So it's not only the deep kind of dark purple, but it has some black, you know, where the dye kind of struck at different rates, and I don't mind that so much. It doesn't do as well at a distance when you look at like the intricate parts of the pattern, like some of the cable-y stuff that's going on, and there's cables over here that run up and down the arm, but that's okay with me because I love this color, and this is going to be for me like a forever sweater. Like, I'm going to kick around in this probably every day of my life if I could. And so I really enjoyed working with yarn. It was kind of a soulful stash, as Sarah, a Hunt of Fiber Trek, would say, because it was local Illinois Shetland, and because I dyed it myself, and I just feel very close to the yarn and very connected to it. And I think it knit up really well. It's very chunky in the ribbing on the bottoms and on the cuffs, and I love the high collar. I mean, I think Isabel Kramer did just a brilliant job on this design. There are small details, like you could add a pocket if you wanted to, so it has these pocket cables over here. I didn't add the pocket, but it's a lovely detail on the sweater. And then I saw that Isabel Kramer did a test with a kind of heathered pink yarn that I've posted about before, and she did a lining on her collar, and then I saw a couple other folks who were test knitting the sweater did a lining on their collar as well. So I'm just going to pull it off here. so you can see it. So I decided, see it in the light, there you go. I decided to go with this is a Dream in Color yarn for the lining. And it is a superwash. I can't remember the colorway of it now. But I will look it up and put it in the show notes. The nice thing about using this superwash for the lining of the collar, is that it does sit very close to my skin up here, and the Shetland wool, because it had so much, not because the wool itself was itchy, but because it has some VM in it, it has some vegetable matter, like lots of hay and little bits and pieces of leaves and things. And so right up against your skin, it feels a little bit prickly. And I'm not too sensitive to wool prickle, and this isn't a sweater that I would wear next to, you know, like I would with bare arms normally. So I don't think it's gonna be a problem, but around my neck, you know, if I were to really button this all the way up, I thought that's gonna be more comfortable. So I went with the superwash. And then the really cool thing about this pattern is that you kind of knit the collar double and turn it over, and you end up with the design on the inside, and it's just really beautiful. So I love that. One thing that I did change about the pattern is that for the collar turn, because it's a turned hem where you're whip stitching, once you turn it, you whip stitch it down here, I put a purl row in right at the top here. See if you can see it in the light. Right up around here, I did one purl row. And the nice thing about doing a purl row is that it allows the fabric to turn very easily, and it leaves a kind of nice edging on the top. So I modified that. A couple other things I'd say about this pattern. Isabel Kramer is a genius. Have I said that yet? Because she is. She has this great side cable coming up right here, right? I mean, it's top down, so it actually starts here and goes down. But when you pick up sleeves for the sweater sleeve, I'm showing you my armpit, sorry. When you pick up stitches for the sweater sleeve, you actually pick them up in such a way that you then continue the cable on in exactly the same fashion as you did for the lower part. And the same thing happens here, you might be able to see it more easily, at the collar. So there's a line here where I picked up stitches for the collar, but you can see that this cable continues almost unaltered as you get into the collar stitches. So it's just touches like that for me that tell me that I'm working on from a pattern that a designer really spent a lot of time and thought when they put a lot of thought into the design as they were working on it. I was really surprised to say that I didn't actually modify the sweater in pretty much any other way. I managed somehow to get gauge with this yarn, and I think it's partially because this yarn was a little bit bulkier than the yarn that was called for in the pattern. I'm a very tight knitter, and so when I swatched this up with the needles that were called for in the pattern, it just happened to work out. The other reason I didn't modify is that I've never done a top-down sweater before, and so this sweater begins in the back and on either side, and then you join for the collar, you work down the back, then you pick up stitches, you work down the front, you join under the arms, and you work down. I'd never done a top-down sweater, and so I was less comfortable getting in there and modifying everything. Now that I've made one, I would feel much more comfortable modifying it. And I think I will need to modify it because I'm gonna knit this sweater again. I have some really pretty pink yarn coming from Aileas in the UK. And that is gonna be my pink version of the sweater. But that yarn is a DK weight, so it'll be a lot less chunky. So I'll need to do a gauge swatch, and I'll need to make sure that I modify the number of stitches, the cast on, increases, decreases, all that kind of stuff. But I feel much more comfortable doing that now that I've done this sweater once with gauge and just following the pattern. So I chalk it up to good gauge, good pattern, great pattern. Isabel Kramer, awesome. I would just want to go out and knit like 10 more of her different sweaters just to learn from her design process. Yeah, so that's my Aileas. And again, as I said, I don't have buttons on the button band yet. I do have button holes over here. So the button holes will accommodate, and the button band will accommodate buttons that are probably about 3/4 to half an inch. And so if you guys have recommendations for good buttons on Etsy that are kind of a little bit funky, please leave some comments for me and let me know so that I can go spend money at wonderful indie shops and get some cool buttons for my sweater. Okay, that is Aileas. Next up is our field trip, which we took to Aniroonz Sheep Company yesterday, on Thursday. We went out there. Jennifer Rose Geyer, who has become a good friend, we exchanged a spin and send with each other, I think it was maybe a year and a half ago, something like that, 2 years ago. And we became friends on, you know, social media. And the last time I was out here, I went to visit her at her home, and we had a really nice conversation. It was a little bit short. We had some other family business going on here that kept me from being able to stay too long and visit, but it was great to go see her. And she actually sent me home. I think I told you those stories of sending me home with a couple of fleece that I ended up washing. And the CVM fleece, actually, there's a video up, and I'll put a link in the show notes to it about how I wash my fleece. And this was the CVM fleece that Jennifer gifted me from Aniroonz Sheep Company. Beautiful fleece. Oh my gosh. I mean, if you see it in that video, once it's washed, even before it's washed, it's gorgeous. But once it's washed, it's just pristine. And I spun up a little sample of it right after I washed it, straight from the lock, because it was so gorgeous. All of this is to say, I was super excited to come back to Colorado and say, hey Jennifer, we're in town, you know, do you want to get together? And she said, come on out to the ranch. So we got to, myself and Spencer and my mother-in-law Marie went out to the Aniroonz Sheep Company. Steve and Nancy own the company out there and the ranch, and they've been doing it for, I think, a little bit over maybe 15 years now, something like that. I'll put links to their the Aniroonz Sheep Company website in the show notes so you can go check them out. So we took a drive out, I think it's in Wellington technically, and it's their set in a beautiful spot, and Spencer brought all of his camera equipment and filmed whatever he could film out there, and he's working on editing and cutting a movie for that, so you'll see that soon. I'll talk about that next time it's available. We walked in, and they have a beautiful setup. I mean, the first thing you notice about Aniroonz Sheep Company is that they are set on this hill overlooking the kind of valley and the prairie, and then you can see the Rocky Mountains just like from their house, from when you're working on the sheep, you know, you just look up and there are like the mountains. I mean, unbelievably gorgeous. They have a little over 100 ewes, I think. They had a couple llamas, a couple alpaca, some turkeys, some chicken, a few horses. I saw a donkey. There were two dogs. You know, so the full menagerie of wonderful animals out there. It was a beautiful, beautiful, like 75 degree day. Everything was dry. There was no mud anywhere. Lambs were being born left and right. I think we walked in and they were inoculating some of the newly born lambs and weighing them and making sure that they were attached to their moms. And that was amazing. We got to hold some lambs. They have five main breeds out there. They have Wensleydale, Lincoln Longwool, Teeswater. They have a CVM Rommeldale cross, and they have Carcool. And Carcool are a more primitive breed that some people might be less familiar with. Their fleece and fiber is often used for rug yarn or weaving. And they're a more primitive breed, so they kind of take more care of themselves. The one that I saw a bunch of mamas with their babies, and the Caracol mama was definitely the most kind of like, she seemed the most instinctual about just like being less interested in humans and more interested in kind of like taking care of her lamb. The other ones were obviously taking care of their lambs. They were all very good mamas. But the Caracol had a very interesting characteristic, beautiful, beautiful sheep. I'll try to insert an image from the Fleece and Fiber source book here so that you can see what they look like. They had black faces, kind of gray fleece, black legs, some of them, the mama that I'm thinking of did. And so that alone, just walking into the pens and holding the lambs and seeing them running around and bleeding and laying down in the shadows of their mothers, and just it was incredible. It was really incredible. And Steve was out there with Jennifer and Matt, and they were working on the inoculations and the weighing and all those kinds of things. They were really efficient at it and really good at it. You could tell they've been doing this a long time. And you could tell that they all really just cared for the animals so much. So if you're interested in getting fleece from the source, you know, and you can't necessarily visit a farm always, but I can tell you, if you want to get really amazing fiber from a great place where they're taking good care of their sheep, Aniroonz Sheep Company is one of the places to go. Really lovely people, good setup. And then after we were out in the pens for a while, we went inside and Jennifer just walked me through another skirting lesson. I mean, I've skirted at home and I've skirted on Kathy's farm, but to talk to Jennifer about it, who's been doing it for a while now and for a sheep company and for show fleeces, it was amazing to see how she goes about the process. Really thinking about presentation of the fleece and what's going to be useful in terms of sorting. So she was sorting the fleece that she had for what would be good for yarn, the blended yarn that's going to go to the mill. She was thinking about, we did one Lincoln long wool fleece, a lamb's fleece, and she was pulling off locks, you know, for the dye pot to just sell dyed locks. And she was thinking about then the rest of that fleece, which was gorgeous. I mean, gorgeous, just lustrous, fine, beautiful. I mean, all of the words you could use to describe this fleece. It was like glowing on the skirting table. So once she had pulled off the locks and skirted, there wasn't even much to skirt, but she carefully skirted the edges and she, you know, folded it up in this perfect little roll that she could then take to the show. And they're off to the Yarn Fest in Loveland, Colorado this next coming weekend. So if any of you viewers out there happen to be in Colorado this next weekend, Aniroonz and Jennifer will be at the Yarn Fest. So head on over and check it out. I wish I were still in Colorado as you're watching this. I'm wishing I were still in Colorado to go to the Yarn Festival. It sounds great. So we had a skirting lesson and we had lunch with Steve and Jennifer's two kids, Joseph and Lily, and they're wonderful, great company. Oh, you know, as we're sitting at the kitchen table, like looking out on the deck and the mountains, it's one of those incredible experiences. You know, the great conversation, we talked about the bear tooths in Montana. Steve's from Montana. Really, unfortunately, Nancy wasn't with us. She was in Idaho teaching. And I miss seeing her. I'm hoping to catch up with her maybe on a next visit sometime. But the conversation was great. It was really fun. And I think, I know Spencer had fun filming. Marie had fun kind of hanging out with people. And she held a lamb for the first time, as did I. I mean, freshly born, like, lamb, just belly button covered in iodine. And, like, just the sweetest thing. So it was great. I can't recommend farm visits enough. If you ever have a chance or you know somebody locally or, you know, you're traveling and you have a network, fiber network, just, you know, seriously call people up, send them an email and just say, can I come out and see your sheep? Because it is one of those experiences that's really, it's like a life-changing experience to see these animals and to experience them in this kind of way. I think Spencer and I were talking about it. We've been, I think, to 6 different farms now, and they're all different. They all do things slightly differently. And it's, for us, it's been really great because we've talked a lot about wanting to raise sheep at some point. And so we're taking our time now and getting to know a lot of different methods. And it's been great to get to know the people. And I feel like we have support. You know, if we were to go out and get sheep and start this whole thing, we'd have people we could call on all over the country, you know, for advice and just to talk to, and it's great. So, Aniroonz Sheep Company, check them out. They're great. Let's see. So, one last bit here is just a few things about acquisitions and shout-outs. So, one thing that Jennifer gave me as I was leaving the farm, and this is some amazing stuff. She has been working, Jennifer Geyer, she's the wool marketing manager for Aniroonz, and she's been really getting their fleece and fiber out on the market and out in social media in some terrific ways. And she's creating new yarns and yarn stories that are incredible. So Sarah Hunt of Fiber Trek talked about the story-based yarns, the first run of them. And you should totally go check out her podcast because it's amazing anyway. But she also talks about Jennifer Geyer's work with Aniroonz and the first story-based yarns. I have in my hands the second and third story-based yarns, which they're called Begin and Partner. And the Begin, which I think went live yesterday as of Thursday. I hope I'm getting the right dates here. This is a Lincoln Lamb wool and CVM wool cross. I'll hold it up here so you can see it. And I love, Jennifer has just done a great job designing the labels for these yarns. They're just beautiful. The yarn itself is a 2-ply. I've got a little bit of hay in there. 2-ply, really gorgeous, soft woolen preparation. But it's strong because it has the long wool in there. And the CVM for softness. So, I mean, you can see this is like a very squishy, lovely yarn. And I can't wait to knit it up to test it out. This is the third story-based yarn. This is Partner. And this is the Wensleydale CVM. So again, a kind of blend of long wool and for strength and luster, and CVM for softness, and crimp and memory. And you can see again, this is a woolen preparation 2-ply. I love the natural colors. It's just so gorgeous. You can see how squishy this is, I think, in the light. I mean, oh, and it's soft. I was joking with Jennifer that when I saw Sarah on FiberCheck holding this yarn, she was pretty much just doing this. And that's pretty much what I want to do with this yarn because it's so soft. And I think that has a lot to do with the woolen preparation. Really incredible. So I'm gonna come up with a perfect pattern to knit something up with this to show you what it looks like. And hopefully I'll talk about that on the next podcast. If you want to get your own story-based yarn from Aniroonz, which I would highly recommend, it's going to be up on the Aniroonz website and on Jennifer. I think you can find out about it on Wild Lily Artisan Fibers, which is Jennifer's website. And since I'm outside, I'm not holding up the computer today. I'm not sure the monitor would actually work out. I'll insert some photos and put things in the show notes so that you can find everything I'm talking about. The other thing Jennifer gave me, which was so sweet, is this beautiful braid of carded Shetland. And this is from her own, this is Wild Lily Artisan Fibers. You can see the tag there. This is a Shetland, carded Shetland, in these beautiful reds and greens and purples and browns. Just so, and it's amazingly soft. I have some Shetland in my stash, and I think it might be because it's older or it wasn't prepared as well, something, and it does not feel like this. This is like, I'd never think of Shetland as like close to the skin kind of wool, but it is, this is just gloriously soft, and I think it was just freshly carded, and it's just crying out for my spinning wheel. So probably as you're watching this, I'm back home sitting at my spinning wheel spinning this up, which is gorgeous, and I would highly recommend Jennifer's, the Wild Lily Artisan Fiber. She makes beautiful story bats that are all these different colors, and they go from inspirations based on different stories and paintings and artworks. She has a brilliant mind for color and thinking about creative uses of color. So check out her website, check out Aniroonz, sheep company website, for all of the goodies I've been talking about. The last couple of things I wanted to give a little shout out to. Since I'm in Colorado, I of course went to the Loopy U, which is one of my favorite places to go here. There are a bunch of wonderful yarn shops in and around Colorado. In Boulder, I'm just gonna talk about Fort Collins because Boulder's a whole nother story. There's beautiful yarn shops there too. The Loopy U, you probably know as like a company that's producing, you can get their stuff online very easily. And indeed, their shop is set up much like a warehouse would be, rows and rows and rows of yarn. And they have a place at the front where they're packing boxes. But if you want to go check out, they have a lot of independent dyers now, and I think they have first. They had more this time than they did last time I was there, which was about a year ago, and I think they're just increasing that kind of supply. They're big supporters of trying to not just sell, you know, the kind of big brands, but also sell some indie dyers. They have a large selection of colors. They have a large range in terms of price, so they have yarn that is less expensive all the way up to yarn that's, you know, $45 a skein, which is, whoa, I can't afford that. But I picked up this yarn that I used for the inner collar on my sweater there. And I picked up, I told Marie, my mother-in-law, while I was here, I said, I want to knit you a pair of socks, but you need to pick out the sock yarn. So she picked up this lovely skein from Fibernymph Dye Works in these kinds of reds and purples. This is their Bounce, which is 80% superwash merino and 20% nylon fingering weight. And I absolutely love the fact that she picked out the colorway that's called Bloodlust. So I'll be knitting these socks for her in the car on the way home, and I'm looking forward to that. And you should check out the Loopy U. The other fiber shops here in town are Lambspun, which is a beautiful boutique-y kind of yarn shop, and Your Daily Fiber, which is where Jennifer Geyer sells some of the Wild Lily Artisan bats. And they do weaving there, and they have other more fiber-related things there. Beautiful shop, wonderful shop. And the last thing I want to talk to you guys about is, of course, many of you may have gotten the recent ply issue on the down breeds and the down like breeds. Totally recommend this because the down wool can be used a lot like a superwash could, because a lot of down wool, and this doesn't mean down like downy, like there are fleeces that have down wool in them, like an Icelandic would have a down part of the, if you take the lock and you pull it apart, that I think it's like the thog and the thel, one's the down and one's the kind of harder, harsher, more rope-like, hairy kind of stuff. Not the Kemp. Anyway, I'm getting it all wrong. Read the issue, you'll understand what I'm talking about. But the down breeds can be used like superwash in some respects, like they are somewhat machine washable and things like that. So, cool issue in terms of that. But one of the things that I was so excited to see in here is that Rachel Smith, who is one of my absolute favorite podcasters about, you know, in terms of thinking about spinning and how spinning works and learning a lot about spinning, she has an article in here, and it is an experimental article about using the down breeds for socks, because she, like me, doesn't want to hand wash socks, so she wanted to do an experiment about whether or not socks knit up with down breed wool would be machine washable and would they wear well. And I love Rachel's experiments. She does so much to help the spinning community on her podcast right now, and this last year I think they've been working on color studies. She does a lot of experimental work, you know, knitting or spinning up samples so that you can see what a color looks like or what a preparation looks like or what a spinning style looks like in terms of plying a ratio. Incredible wealth of information. I feel like every spinner should be watching her podcast and reading her blog posts, and now reading her articles that are appearing in Ply. So congratulations, Rachel. This looks great, and I can't wait to dig into it a little bit more. So that's it for shout outs for today, and I hope you all are well. I'm gonna be heading back to Illinois and back to regular life and work and teaching my online class, but that's gonna be cool. So, because I'll do it all in my new sweater. Please, by the way, if you have button suggestions, send them to me, comment, let me know, because I'd love to put some cool funky buttons on this sweater and be able to give a shout out both to the Etsy store where I found them and to the whoever leads me to them as a kind of assist, you know. So wherever you're off to, wherever you're returning to, I hope your knitting and spinning adventures go well, and I will see you next time. Thanks for tuning in. Take care, everybody.